Thank you, panelists, for such an engaging discussion. The next panel discussion, Identity and Its Discontents, The Danger of a Single Narrative, will be moderated by Preeti Dawra, columnist for Mint Asia and strategic advisor to ISAS. Joining her on the panel are Manu Joseph. Manu Joseph is the author of the prize-winning novels Serious Men and The Illicit Happiness of Others. He writes a regular column for the International New York Times titled Letter from India, which is widely read. Next up, we have Moni, Mohsin. Moni Mohsin is a well-known Pakistani writer and columnist. She started her writing career at the Friday Times, Pakistan's first independent weekly. She is the author of several prize-winning novels, including The End of Innocence and Duty Free. And finally, joining us on the panel, we have Tishani Doshi. Tishani is a leading Indian poet, writer, and dancer. She is the recipient of an Eric Gregory Award for Poetry, and her first book, Countries of the Body, won the prestigious Ford Prize for Best First Collection. I will now pass the floor to Preeti.
Welcome to all the writers on the stage here. I want to jump right into what is the topic of this panel, which is identity and its discontents and the dangers of a single narrative. We all know that in South Asia, and especially in India and Pakistan, we have either an assertive identity or a defensive identity. So I want to ask you to illuminate here for our guests, what are some of the discontents that you see in your nations, in your work, and how do you negotiate that?
From where I come, there are so many problems. There are so many discontents that I need to arrange them in alphabetical order. So let's start with, I suppose, do you want to just choose one? What's on your mind?
Well, I think there's gender, there's religion, there is political affiliation.
So I'll avoid all that. See, I'm a South Indian, and I now live in Delhi. And the proof that always stated that there's a lot of turmoil in Europe, and they're trying to figure out what the union is. And as a South Indian who lives in North India, it just brings a chuckle to me, because I have figured that what makes a nation is not all the things that people say it is. In fact, in India, very good academics and writers are trying to figure out what's India. And you would usually hear them say it's something called Bollywood, which is actually Punjabi film industry based in Bombay. And they would say it's English, but actually 1% can speak. I think a lot of people can understand it. It is the language of power. It is the new Sanskrit. Then they try to figure out, they bring in something called ethos. When people talk about ethos, it means they don't know what they're talking about. And they talk about Indian values, family values, which Indian traditional family values just mean this, that when your government is not working, your family has to work. If you don't have a family which works, you're pretty much doomed in a poor country, because the government is not going to take care of you. So because your family takes good care of you, you have to respect that family. And it appears to have certain values. That's why as a society progresses, the family shrinks. It's not a coincidence. You just don't need a lot of peripheral relatives. Just kick them out, because they're not required, because the economy and the level of governance is improved, so you don't need those things. So I'm questioning all the central things that people claim contribute to the idea of India. And when I was growing up in Chennai, in fact, only very recently I could call it Chennai. I always used to call it Madras, because when I was growing up, it was called Madras. when Indira Gandhi would visit Tamil Nadu, she would have to speak in English. If she spoke in Hindi, we would have assassinated her then. Now, Narendra Modi, for all his pride on what is India, when he visited Bangalore for the first time as Prime Minister, he spoke in English. And actually, that was a very good speech. I was very impressed with that speech that he gave, though I think by now he could have spoken in Hindi and he would have been safe. So Modi is always safe, which is a different issue. And once I was interviewing a very dangerous man called Pravin Togadia when I was a journalist with Outlook, and my Hindi can make people laugh. And he told me, what kind of an Indian are you with this kind of Hindi? So my next three questions to him was in Tamil. And this is a few Indian nationalists who didn't understand an Indian language. So I didn't tell him that, I didn't have to tell him anything, he just kind of laughed. So I feel that there are all these tensions are about many identities. So the moral of the story is that what makes a nation is just the habit. Someone told us this is the country, and we studied it in school, and we got used to it. It's like a long marriage. You don't know whether you're happy or unhappy, but you know you're married. Thank you.
Moni, would you like to talk about what's happening in Pakistan and how you negotiate that?
I was educated in Lahore. I grew up in Lahore. And I went to a missionary school run by Irish nuns, Catholic nuns, and Ramananda also Pakistani nuns. And my best friend was a Christian girl, and we spoke English at the school because that was what they insisted upon. But we also spoke Urdu amongst ourselves, and when we went home, we spoke Punjabi. And my mother is a Shia, my father is a Sunni, and I considered myself Pakistani. Today, my best friend no longer lives in Pakistan. She has had to migrate. Her family has migrated along with a lot of other Christian girls who live at school with me. They have migrated because they don't find Pakistan a hospitable place anymore. They had many generations of their family lived there. They're as Pakistani as anybody else. But they were not made to feel Pakistani. And the general Zia, things changed in Pakistan. I was at university in England at the time, and I missed quite a lot. I was actually doing my GCSE exams when Bhutto was arrested and then hanged. And then General Zia took over, and he slowly changed Pakistan, and he made it into an Islamic country. We were already Muslims, obviously, but he felt we were not Muslim enough. We had to be made more Muslim. And Pakistan had to become a fortress of Islam. And the army was going to be the guardian of this fortress. And if you question that, then you were either questioning Islam, which made you into an apostate, or you were questioning the role of the army, which made you into a traitor. So it became a difficult time. And I remember when I just came back from, but I missed most of this because I was away to university at that time. And when I came back, I went to see a film in Lahore with a few female friends. And it was such a shock because we were surrounded suddenly. I noticed that we were very few women now in the cinema hall. And we were suddenly surrounded by a group of jeering, chanting men who said, go home. And they were chanting Chadar or Char Diwari. Chadar is a shawl which covers you completely. Char Diwari is a four walls. And they were shouting at us to go back into what they thought we should be confined to.
So and they were defining your identity suddenly?
They were telling me what I should do and who I should be. I should be a shroud woman in my home. And it came as a shock. And then I started working for a newspaper, the Friday Times, and one of the first things I did was to try and find my old Christian friends. I wanted to do an article on them because I'd heard that they'd suffered a lot. And I met this girl who was at that time packing to leave. And I said to her, why are you leaving? And she said, because, she said, you know, we have always lived here, we've always been part of this country. But the day I stopped feeling a part of this country was when I was crossing the Mal Road, and there was a big sign across the road which said, Pakistan ka matlab kya, la ilaha illallah. So what is the meaning of Pakistan? The meaning of Pakistan is the first kalama of Kalama-e-Tawheed of Islam. She said that disenfranchised me there and then. Then I admit I had no place in Pakistan. Since then, the Ahmadis have been victimized, Christians have been killed, and now Shias have been targeted, Ismailis have been targeted. And slowly it seems to me that the identity of a Pakistani is now becoming Sunni, Muslim, Sunni, Punjabi male. Everybody else is an outsider. And it's not enough just to exclude them, they also have to be stigmatized. And then the single narrative inevitably breeds violence.
I also want to ask you how the identity of Pakistan is defined by India today versus what it has been in the past few decades. Has anything changed positively or negatively with the new government?
I think you'll have to ask an Indian that question. I can only tell you how our relationship with India is. I know that every Pakistani loves Bollywood. So they identify with that aspect of India, but the official narrative is that they are enemies. I know that businessmen are dying to trade with India, but the army will not let them. I know that when I travel to Pakistan, to India, and I meet people who had been at school with my parents and who welcomed me into their homes, a lot of them are Sikh families, I find that I have much more in common with them than probably they do with South Indians, or I do with Baluchis, or I do with Pathans, because we speak the same language, we eat the same food, we have the same poetry. And I think it is this, it comes as a surprise to Indians and Pakistanis who have not been across the border when they do go across. At the Lahore Literary Festival, Indian writers said to me, but we didn't know it was so nice. But we didn't know people were like this here. Because the official story is so different.
I was at the Lahore Literary Festival this year and I thought I was sitting in Sri Fort Auditorium in Delhi. It was that similar.
Except for the security.
Yes. Tishani, would you like to speak?
Yeah, well, I actually live in the city of Chennai, which I call Ras, and being a kind of mongrel person, I have no affiliation or no actual lineage that links me to that city, but I grew up with a desperate need for identity. I don't know why. I'm a middle child, and I had all these issues, and I wanted to have something. You know, my mother's Welsh and Protestant, kind of. My father's Gujarati and kind of Jain, and I just thought, well, you know, what am I and how do I belong? So I started to call myself a Madrasi, and I still call myself a Madrasi, even though I'm not in terms of blood. And one of the things I found, well, two identities which I feel I have to defend always. One is this Madrasi tag, and that's only within India. Because the minute you go north of India, it's like this, you live in Madras, but why? As if, you know, it's a strange city, it's a very bizarre place. I'll give you that, it's one of India's strangest places. But so this explanation, I have to explain why. And I think going to the north or east or west of the country, it's a completely different planet for me, you know. The second identity is this thing of being a woman, and an Indian woman. And now whenever I go on any kind of book talk, or the first question is, tell us about the situation of Indian women, which is a question I feel it's bizarre and uncomfortable, because I don't feel that I'm an ambassador for Indian women. I don't feel I can speak for them. I understand the concern, but you know, I don't understand why nobody asks a man, like, what does it mean to be an Indian man? Because frankly, I think that we should be looking at the idea of masculinity rather than always talking about the idea of how difficult it is to be a woman. I would imagine that in India now today, you have to explain what it means to be a man in India, because, you know, all of these news items is talking about Indian men as if they were all horrible people. And so I think those are the two things in which, as a sort of writer or a person who has to speak about country often along with your work, those are the two things that I speak. But I've never lived in any other city in India other than Madras, so I feel very close to it, and it's a kind of love-hate relationship. So all of my work is there. I mean, it has always been about that city.
Tell us a little bit about why you chose to be a poet. I was doing some research, and there aren't that many contemporary Indian poets as there used to be. And how did you choose this, and what is this journey been like?
Well, nobody chooses to be a poet. It's not a rational decision as far as I'm concerned. I think it's something that you feel you must do. You know, poetry is I think, the most authentic of the art form, because there is nothing that you get from it in terms of, so you can always believe a poet because they are only doing it because they have to do it. There is no hidden wonders of being a poet. There's no money, there's no fame, there's no, you know, it's only for your own obsession, as it were. And for me it was the same. I kind of went off with the idea of doing a business degree as a Gujarati/Protestant girl, and of doing something very useful. And then I discovered poetry, and it kind of did something to me, because I thought, well, actually, I love this, and I want to do this, and I want to become that. But I sort of had that in America, where it is possible to do things which, at the time in India, seemed impossible. You know, if you were a writer, you were going to be a journalist, not a novelist even at the time, not a poet. And somehow it feels, and I don't know, I feel there are a lot of Indian contemporary poets at the moment. I have a lot of friends who are, you know, there's a sense of the internet has made things possible and given poets a platform. That could be a good thing or a bad thing. And I think Hanif said something about the fact that, you know, every person has a book inside, and I think everybody on some level thinks they're a poet, and, you know, they're probably not.
I'd like to ask our writers now about actually their books, and how do you come up with the identity of the characters? How do they emerge from you? How do they live with you? And how do they shape you?
Well, I'll talk about my first book. When I was working as a journalist, I used to meet a particular kind of man, I should say, who had a particular kind of an anger inside him. And it was a very non-English anger. So English-speaking people in India have rarely seen him angry. Though Indians hate this word vernacular, but at a different level, there was this anger, and these were very, very intelligent people who were very politicized, but were not political. And what they were talking about, like, for example, I would speak to some Dalit intellectuals, and they can link a Nokia phone to untouchability. They could link anything to their misery, to their suffering, and they were all poets. And they were authentic, they were sincere, they were pissed off. And I was wondering how to capture this anger, because I found it very poignant and comical. Because I don't know how there is no violence every day in India, honestly, because the wealth of India is in plain sight. And a majority of people live in very horrible conditions and who are very angry. And the only reason why I feel there is no daily violence, as in mindless daily violence, where a guy is just walking and then he looks at a car, takes a stone and throws it. I know he wants to, but he doesn't, and I wondered why. But I think electoral politics, in India, electoral politics works. That's one of those things which work. Because there are hundreds of political parties. They have ensured that the election commission is a reasonably fair system because everybody has a stake in the electoral politics working so that they can make money later, which is a different issue. But at the election level, it has to work. So every Indian feels that he has a release in politics, in electoral politics, the process of politics. So there were different kinds of angry people. Like for example, when I came to Bombay, I was a 21-year-old, and there was a gym run by the Shiv Sena right next to where I live. I don't know if you're aware of Shiv Sena, so just, maybe I'm not going to introduce them, but you soon understand what they are. So I just walk into the gym, and that guy tells me, so Joseph, okay, you have to do 50 push-ups for Hanuman. So there was a portrait of Hanuman standing like this. And he said, you do 50 push-ups as a membership, it's a membership thing. 25 rupees and 50 push-ups. So I did my 50 push-ups. And then he gave me a long red cloth and a long blue cloth, which I took one day of problem-solving ability to figure out. These were langos. Because underwear is Western. So this is langur is a loin. So it was never saffron for some reason. Why? I would have thought you should have given me a saffron langur. So this is a different kind of a rage. These were also not rich men. They were also poor men. But the mystery of Shiv Sena was that for all the Western, all their antipathy towards what is Western, they had a mysterious habit. I lived in Prabhadevi area where Shiv Sena had their shakas, where they would have their regular monthly get-togethers. It would start with devotional songs about Shivaji. In fact, they had to name everything after Shivaji. Shivaji is the only hero that they had. And for Rastak, when he came, the boss can't do things beyond Shivaji. Then he realized he has to change tack, and you can't question Shivaji and survive in Maharashtra. But that's a different issue. They start with Shivaji, and then there'll be patriotic songs about India, Mother India. And then they would play Barbie, which mystified me. But then I realized that they were young guys, and that time the song was a rage. And after they got drunk, they were not nationalists or anything. They were just guys. And so politics, the political process, is the only form of fun, the social. So I wanted, in my first novel, I wanted to capture the anger of what Bengali critics would call subaltern, because nobody else uses that word anymore. And in fact, it's very interesting, we're very academically oriented people who talk about the famous paper, Does the Subaltern Speak? And it's really funny because when my subaltern, who was Iron Money, who was from that strata of the society, when he spoke, they couldn't take it. Because when the subaltern male speaks, he is also going to talk about women, because the first scene is this man is walking on a promenade in Bombay, and he is looking at everything he can't afford, and everything which is unattainable to him, which of course includes the sea face apartments, people with people in cars, but it also includes the affluent women who are passing by, and he looks at all of them. In fact, he connects BlackBerry, those days there were no iPhones, BlackBerry phones, Mercedes car, Seaview homes, and women. You know, to whom he had to put everything together because these were the things, or these were the aspects of life which were beyond. It's very unpleasant. You know, so I was challenged by the unpleasantness of a certain voice. Sorry, I think it took a long time.
That was very interesting. So these were the identity tools, so to speak, that he aspired to. You have written, Moni, several books, but one of them that has, you know, got a lot of attention is this very provocative diary of a social butterfly. Can you tell us a little bit about that? And it has a lot of humor and wit, and I think it looks at Pakistani society from up here, down below, and what does it look like?
You know, as Manu just said, you cannot live in South Asia and be unaware of the huge disparities in wealth. And in Pakistan, the wealthy have just receded. So they've withdrawn into these big compounds with high walls and shards of glass and security people outside. And they live in these very sort of, I don't want to call them bubble, because bubble is a kind of, is a very transient thing, and you know, it's a very fragile thing, but they live in these kind of fortresses as well. And they only sort of hang out with each other, and they pretend that all the horrible things that are happening outside are not really happening. And so my Diary of a Social Butterfly started life as a column in a newspaper in the Friday Times, and it came about quite by accident. I had been writing, my editor had told me to write a column on women in Pakistan, on the lives of women, and I had to talk about the concerns of women. So it could be working women, it could be the difficulties of living in a joint family system, it could be anything, motherhood, whatever. I chose to write about the travails of a working woman in Pakistan, and I used myself for that. And I did it for about a year, and I had to turn my own life inside out. And this is in the days before Facebook and blogging, now it's become, you're considered a freak if you don't want to tell everybody everything about yourself. But at that time, I felt like a freak because I had to tell everybody everything about myself all the time, and I felt that I didn't have any sort of private life left. So I went to my editor and I said, look, I can't do this column anymore, and you've got to excuse me. And he said, well, what about the readers? They want it now. So I said, well, they'll have to find something else. He said, no, you will have to find something else. So he said, you come up with another column. If you don't want to write this column, you'll come up with something else. And I thought to myself, what can I write? And then I am fascinated by two things. One is, and I think most writers do this, although they pretend they don't, they eavesdrop constantly on other people's conversations. I am a very, very practiced eavesdropper. So while I'm actually reading the newspaper, I'm listening to what people are saying all around me. And the other thing I'm really fascinated by is two things. One is our language and how we have changed the English language. And the third is society. I'm very intrigued by how it works and how people justify things to themselves and how relations work and how networks work. So anyway, I had all these things in my mind. I had gone to a lunch party, a very sort of swish lunch party in Lahore, where there were a lot of begums and city gents and stuff. And I was sitting there eating quietly and, as always, eavesdropping. And I eavesdropped on this conversation between two ladies. And do you know what a shatoosh is? A shatoosh is a kind of shawl made out of goat hairs, and the goat is now almost extinct, so it is banned, I think, in India. In Pakistan, people still wear it a lot. And it's very, very, very expensive. And so it was cold, and there was this lady who was wearing a shatoosh. She was small, large, and big diamond earrings. And she was sort of swathed in this shatoosh, and she was talking to a lady of an uncertain age with long, glossy hair and a chiffon sari despite the cold, and a tiny blouse. And so the lady in the shatoosh went up to this other lady and she said, I just bought this shatoosh, na? It's a 7-yard shatoosh. I had one which was 3 yards, another one just 2.5, but I thought, tell you, 7 yards is also nice to have one. And then she said to the other one, she said, how many shatooshes do you have? And this woman said, I don't wear shatoosh, you know? I think in a shawl one looks very much like a serving woman. And she flicked her hair and she walked off. And I thought, this is what I should write about. These are the voices, these are the people, these are the concerns. And so Diary of a Social Butterfly was born. And, the protagonist is this very privileged, very shallow housewife, very frivolous, who is not very well educated, and so her English is a little bit dodgy. So she's always calling, there's so many business typhoons came to our house yesterday, and we had a 3-tiara cake made for them.
and they laughed so much they became historical with laughter. I love it, and I've almost become a butterfly myself in the process, because occasionally I just confuse things and I keep talking about business type. So the sort of fact and fiction have merged within me.
My first novel, you know, there's a famous quote by Archibald, which says, to have a writer in the family is to have a traitor in it. And so I am the traitor in my family, because I did the thing that you do with your first novel sometimes, is that you write a kind of autobiographical fiction about your weird family, because everybody has one. And although I thought it was quite a tender, sweet look at them, you know, nobody in my family read my book. They just refused to, not my mother, my father, or my sister. And at first it really bothered me, because I said, you know, hello, it's dedicated to you, why don't you read it? And my mother really hated it when people came up to her and said, I love you in the book, and she said, that's not me. And, you know, and I realized actually I crossed a line without even thinking about it, because I wanted to write a reverse immigration story about, because I met lots of these kinds of women like my mother growing up in Madras, which were German, Danish, Dutch, whatever, women who met Indian men in whatever circumstance. And instead of going to live in America or Canada or England or whatever, they chose to come back to India. And that decision, I thought, was very interesting, because we have in our history of our literature many of the stories of the journey west. But then this journey, I thought, what are the concerns that come with that? So I wanted to write about that, and I just was very lazy by using whatever was right next to me, which was my family. And and then my sister had another problem with it. She said, well, because I wrote about childhood, which is something I love writing about, and I think which is very important for writers. I get a lot from childhood. And I wrote about, you know, what it meant to grow up in Madras and in this strange family. And my sister said, well, you know, I started reading it, then I started reading all this memory bit, and I stopped, because you are taking my memories and you're making it something else. And the point is that we all remember things differently. You grow up in the same house and you have a completely different recollection. So my sister and I remember everything differently. And by writing it, I had given it more power. Because as we were talking earlier, that when you write it, it feels like it's the truth. No matter if you put the word novel on the front, everybody still wants to read in what's the truth into that. And so, I was playing with that, and I sort of, there is something that's true, there's a lot that's made up. But it was painful actually for me to have that. I enjoyed writing it, but after that I thought, you know, that's just, it's too much. So my next book, which I published, was a novella called Fountainville, and it was a commissioned piece. It was about retelling a Welsh myth from the Mabinogi. And it's a very weird story called The Lady and the Fountain, and I could tell it in whatever way. And I said, you know, I'm not going to use a single thing from what I know. Like, nothing is based on anyone I know, because I wanted to see whether it's possible to also just completely imagine from nothing the characters. And so that book was actually inspired by a piece of journalism work that I did. I did some work with Doctors Without Borders. I did a story on healthcare in Nagaland, and which is, again, a completely different kind of place. And so if Madras is the mecca of what they call medical tourism, Nagaland is the opposite, because the hospital they had there had not changed since 1965. They were reusing syringes and gloves, and everything was completely ramshackle. And then I went there and I found out about the headhunters and about the fact of the problem of drugs coming in, the fact that they wanted to be independent from India, and all of these things. And I thought, okay, I'm going to set my imaginary town of this Welsh myth here in this place, but I'm not going to name it that it's Nagaland, because one of the burdens, I think, also of identity is that you are expected to write about where you are from, particularly if you are from particular places. Like, I go to a lot of festivals, and I never hear American writers have to explain the American context, because everybody understands it. It's the predominant context in the English-speaking world, or English, or Australian. But if you come from India or Pakistan or Bangladesh, you are expected to speak a little bit about your country and where you come from, because that's the interest. So part of my thing with writing this novella was that I didn't want it to be identifiably India or Nagaland or anything. I just wanted to be an imaginary place. And it was hard to do because place is very important for writing, and it is for me. But that was one of the challenges.
So we have only 2 minutes left now. I just want to ask, what role do you think that writers and poets play? And not at this level, but you know, to your own, as a response to your own columns, Manu, and to your books, and you know, to your poetry. Do you think that you shape society in any way? Do people, I mean, how do they respond to you?
Well, very quickly, right from a very impressionable age, I've seen very self-important writers. So I decided my role is to be peripheral and to talk about things which are not important, but facial expressions and not at the very core of some historical big development. And secondly, always, in fact, I wanted to ask the question to the previous panel, but I couldn't. I wonder why writing is so moralistic. Is because writers are so often jerks. But when they write, they are so moral. And all questions, everything is about the righteousness of things. And so I feel that if writers want to be honest and authentic, I think the, at least some writers like me, the imperfect people, you have to talk, you have to have the guts to write about what is bothering your mind and what you want to say, not what is probably modern. Probably writing is a model endeavor, but I don't understand why it is and why writers are not as moral as their writing is.
I think, well, I don't think that writers have a say in shaping society or that are very important. I think for people who read, writers can be important and they have an effect on them. But in terms of shaping or even pronouncing things, I mean, the very few times that I put on the TV in India, I'm shocked because like there's an earthquake somewhere and the bottom tagline says, Bipasha Basu tweets, whatever. And I just think, well, they're not looking to what writers think about any kind of disaster or happening, or I mean, writers are trotted out on a few occasions, but I don't think that that place of the writer, which used to be of the writer who's, you know, bringing some kind of pronouncement or morality or whatever, I just don't think there's even that kind of space in India, because you know, it's reserved for politicians, sports people, actresses. That's the mainstream, that's what people are reading about and care about. And I think that the small margin of population who know of writers and read books, they might be affected by it, and that's the hope. But I would say that we are all standing quite on the edge, I think.
I'll be very brief. I agree with Tishani that I don't think I have the same following as Imran Khan. But I think that I certainly don't shape society in any way. But the 5 or 10 people who read my books have told me that I reflect society. I don't shape it, but I reflect it in my writing. Because, and I know this, because they always come and say to me, I know who Butterfly is based on. I know, I met her. And I say, really, who is it based on? And they name somebody. I say, no, it's not. It's Dinaini Kuro. I know. And everybody's very keen that they know that this person exists. They know that, they think that they know just who it is. But they never say, I've only ever met 2 people in the whole time that I've been writing this column, and it's been more years than I care to admit. Only 2 Pakistani women have come up to me and said, I feel you're writing about me.
Just an important point that I feel is important. In 10 seconds, I feel writers have also evolved into people who are not necessarily writers, but they have transformed into other professionals. You take Steve Jobs, maybe 100 years ago, you look at the person he is, he has a writer's personality. But he chose not to write, but he chose to do something else, something which is as creative. And I feel writers are being more influential today by not being writers. It's probably a good idea.
That's something to think about. Thank you so much.